Ah, back for more, I see. One video on rotting sea blobs wasn't enough. Good. But before we continue examining new globsters, remember that horribly obvious Ataka carcass, which was just a whale misinterpreted as a tusked monster? Well, apparently cases just like that have fooled people for hundreds, if not thousands, of years. Yeah, really. Numerous ancient sea maps from the Middle Ages to the Renaissance, such as the Carta Marina, commonly depict terrifying large tusked hog-headed sea serpents. It is very likely these monstrous aquatic pigs originate from baleen whale carcasses. With, just like Ataka, the tusk-like appearance of the baleen whale's lower jaws were misinterpreted as that of a massive boar or pig, thus sparking legends of colossal tusked sea monsters. Some illustrations take this misinterpretation a step further by adding two or three sets of tusks. These types of sea monsters are seen extremely common in ancient maps and have been given a proper name. Well, sea swine. It's likely these artists did not depict such bizarre animals from life, but are, in reality, basing these beasts off the skeletal remains of baleen whales, which were misinterpreted as what was most familiar to the artist. An animal with tusks? A wild boar in the ocean, of course. It's cool to see there's some basis to old myths, and guess what? Hundreds of years later, and people are still making the same mistakes. Again, I wish I could take the credit for spotting this, but all the credit belongs to Michael, who, as well as tell me about this, made several of the amazing globster sketches in this video. Very interesting indeed, Michael. Thank you. Alrighty, enough of that biz. Next up on our next examination of various mystery corpses throughout history is Trunco. No, not Trumpy, although that would be really awesome. No, it's Trunco. Oh yes, Trunco, one of the more famous and rather bizarre globsters, and is probably up there with one of the strangest cryptids ever. Our story starts out on October 25th, 1924, not 1922 as many sources incorrectly claim, off the coast of Margate, South Africa, when local farmer Hugh Balance claimed to have seen a spectacular sight out in the sea. By use of binoculars, Hugh saw a battle between two orcas and a massive white furry creature, which he compared most to a giant polar bear. Most bizarre of all, it was said to have possessed an elephant-like trunk. Holy crap, this really is starting to sound like Trumpy, just an albino version. The creature battled the two predators for 3 hours and used its tail to strike the whales. Holy crap, this sounds like he'd be great in a Jackie Chan movie. But alas, in the end, the furry monster floated lifeless and defeated on the surface of the ocean. Well, that's depressing. That evening, the beast washed ashore, attracting much attention. The corpse was massive. Locals measured it to be 5 feet high and 47 feet in overall length, with its tail taking up 10 of that length. Eyewitness accounts of the carcass vary a bit. Some claim it had a furry tail, while others claim it had a almost arthropodal, almost lobster-like tail. All agree it had an elephantine trunk, apparently in the place of the head. The trunk was 5 feet long and 4 inches across. Its tip was said to look like that of a pig. The entire body was covered in long filament-like fur, white in color. The creature certainly resembles nothing from the living nor fossil record, leading many to believe that it was an entirely unknown creature. Curiously, even after such a violent and aggressive clash with the orcas described by Hugh, there was no sign of blood anywhere. Curiouser, curiouser. As said before, the carcass attracted an enormous amount of curiosity by locals, to the point of a group of people apparently brought a team of 32 oxen to haul it not inland, but seaward, meaning they were bringing it back out to the ocean for some reason? Nobody cared to record its weight or take samples of the carcass, and after 10 days it was reclaimed by the sea and was never recovered. Like Stronsay, unfortunately, no scientist came to examine the intact carcass, nor did they take any samples or really any physical evidence. Several months later, London's Daily Mail published an article concerning the event called Fish Like a Polar Bear. The story later drifted off into obscurity, where it became widely regarded as a tall tale without any photographs of the carcass nor any physical evidence to prove that it even occurred. That was, until a blogger and scientist decided to investigate the curious case. Zoologist Dr. Carl Schuker, a major investigator in the cryptozoology community, decided to take a look into the event to see if it really was a hoax or happened at all. His research was surprising, revealing evidence that such a bizarre carcass really did occur, and he was able to rediscover four of the only known images taken of the carcass in 2010 and 2011. He gave the carcass a proper name, Trunco, how appropriate, after another African globster, Gambo. More on that later. Trunco is often regarded by proponents that the carcass is evidence of an unknown animal as a wholly unknown group of aquatic mammals that have remained entirely unknown to science. And, well, that's about it. So what to say about Trunco? What was it? Well, the main problem many experts have met when trying to discover the identity of Trunco is the main lack of any physical evidence to go off of. The few images we have don't really yield much to tell us anything other than this carcass was extremely decomposed. And simply due to no one of any real scientific credentials examining the carcass, we really shouldn't completely trust eyewitness descriptions either. One of the things that the photographs have helped scientists identify is that the supposed fur of Trunco is actually nothing more than exposed connective tissue fibers, just like those seen in Strontze. This suggests the carcass did not have fur at all in life. The standing theory among zoologists such as Darren Nisch and Carl Schuker is that the carcass is that of a decomposing whale, basking shark, or whale shark. As said in the previous episode, basking sharks and whale sharks decompose rather quickly, often leaving only the internal skeleton and connective tissues. These tissues resemble and are often mistaken for fur. It is also probable that the supposed trunk is nothing more than the head and neck of the shark, as the gill apparatus of a basking shark and whale shark decomposes quickly, leaving only a long appendage covered in hair-like tissues, which might superficially resemble a trunk. Remember, the eyewitnesses claimed the animal lacked a head. It is possible the reason for this is because the trunk was the head. Another likely explanation is that the carcass is possibly like the St. Augustine carcass, and is just a bunch of whale blubber that has become detached from the rest of the body. Various species of whales live in the area, and the decomposing remains of which are a common meal among orcas. In both cases, you get a white furry carcass which could, to the untrained eye, resemble something a lot like Trunco. From all this, we can conclude on one thing. Trunco was most likely long dead, as opposed to just dying a few hours ago. The fact the carcass possessed connective tissue fibers and not fur further proves this assumption. But what about Hugh's claim to see the animal alive, yet with tissue fibers exposed, something only a long dead corpse could have possessed? Well, first we should start out by saying Hugh's account has been met with some scrutiny, as many regard it as a just straight up coax. He has no photographic or physical evidence to really support his claim. But for the matter of discussion, let's side with a few cryptozoologists and say he actually saw two orcas attacking some animal out there in the ocean. Explain the fact the carcass was seen living with fur. Well, many skeptics have given explanations to this as well. Assuming the sighting did occur, that doesn't necessarily mean the furry trunked monster was alive, and not just a decomposing carcass. Explaining the lack of blood. Orcas are widely known to play and launch their food up into the air. Carha supposed that the onlookers who claimed the carcass was alive could have easily been fooled by this display and believed the long-dead carcass to be alive and fighting. The movements of the carcass by Hugh seem to fit this explanation, as the motions of the carcass, such as jumping out of the water and doing a mid-air tail kick, seems to be something no live animal would do, and would have simply been a product of orcas tossing their food around. And even if we do side with a few proponents and say the animal was indeed alive, and not just a trick, I will give another possible explanation. Hugh might have been observing orcas attacking an albino southern right whale with an erect penis. The southern right whale is common to the region and resembles the fatty look of Trunco. Orcas are known to attack right whales as well. The species is known to exhibit albinism, thus giving the live Trunco its white color. And what about the trunk? Well, this species of whale has a massive penis, which may superficially resemble a trunk when most of the body is submerged, only this section of the body is visible. And the furry carcass that later washed up on shore was an entirely unrelated incident. I propose that the living Trunco and the Trunco that washed up on shore were two separate animals. It might seem far-fetched, and the previous explanation sounds more plausible to me, but let's just remember this second one is certainly more plausible than a weirdo trunked white fish lobster unknown to science. Well, regardless, one fact remains. We simply lack sufficient evidence to make a solid conclusion on the identity of the carcass. Many still regard the carcass as an enigma, but one should always value more plausible explanations before you jump to conclusions that this animal was unknown wholly to science. I know this is a rather unsatisfactory conclusion, but it's the best we can do with such little to go on. So, Trunco remains uncertain, but it's most likely the decomposing remains of a shark or whale, which was tossed around by orcas, mistaken to be alive, and washed up on shore. That's at least the most plausible conclusion. Over it was an elephant sea monster. Darren Nisch says it best, calling the unknown elephant monster explanation dodgy and unlikely to be accurate or faithful, which I think summarizes the situation best. Next up we got Gambo. The story of Gambo is a long and interesting one, which involves decapitation and the president of Gambia's brother. I find it troubling that I actually had to use those two topics in the same sentence. Well, anyways, our story begins in Bungalow Beach, Gambia. On the morning of June 12, 1983, a 15-year-old boy and amateur wildlife enthusiast, Owen Burnham, supposedly discovered a beach carcass of an unidentified marine animal. Owen claimed the carcass could not be identified as anything from his zoology books. He described a carcass around 15 feet long, possessing a narrow snout filled with 80 sharp teeth, a flukeless lizard-like tail, and two pairs of paddle-like limbs. though apparently one rear paddle was torn off, revealing some intestines. It possessed smooth, grayish-brown skin. The creature superficially resembled a marine reptile, most similar to the extinct group of short-necked plesiosaurs known as pliosaurs. The animal was lying on its belly. Owen claimed to have taken measurements of the carcass extensively. Soon, some locals came and decapitated the corpse, sold the head to a tourist, and then buried the carcass under the beach.
Boy, that escalated quickly. I mean, that really got out of hand fast.
Yeah, it really did. I mean, holy crap, that came the heck out of nowhere. And well, that's where the story ends, right there. Burnham forgot his camera that day, so we don't have any pictures of it. Only a sketch of it made by Burnham. Burnham later wrote up his account to the magazine BBC Wildlife and was published in 1986. The proposed carcass would later be given the name Gambo. Dr. Carl Schuker would later investigate the case and interview many of the first-hand eyewitnesses, such as Burnham's family and multiple locals, apparently even the ones that cut off its head and sold it, all of which thought the carcass was that of a dolphin. With the help of Burnham, repeated attempts have been made to dig up the carcass. One of the suspected burial sites apparently had a nightclub built directly on top of it, and funny enough, the owner of the nightclub was the president of Gambia's brother, who allowed them to search for the creature's remains. All attempts have turned up absolutely nothing, and some sources claim the current suspected location of remains now has a police station located directly on top of them. Great. Cryptozoologists have given multiple fantastical theories on the identity of the carcass, the most popular being a late surviving pliosaur, mosasaur, or metrolinctid crocodilomorphs, which have escaped the entire fossil record for over 66 million years. Again, don't give me that coelacanth crap. Coelacanths are red herring. I will devote an entire episode discussing why coelacanths are a bad comparison to all these extinct tetrapods I just listed. Well, anyways, thoughts? What a weird and bizarre story. Needless to say, many believe the story to be fantasy and a complete fabrication by Burnham. Darren Nish doubts the corpse even exists, and considering we have absolutely no physical evidence, things aren't looking good for Gambo. So let's just look at the story first and see if it sounds the least bit plausible. The story raises a whole bunch of intriguing questions that are kind of funny when you think about them. Like, who the heck decided to bring their machete to the beach that day? Hey, Jeremy, you want to go to the beach? Yeah, let me just grab my machete before. You know, just in case we find the carcass of a prehistoric marine reptile and then need to cut off its head to make a quick buck. Oh, that makes sense. Smart thinking, man. Also, don't forget your sunscreen. Also, how does transaction work? Like, how much is one freshly chopped extinct marine reptile head worth? I'm guessing from $100 to $1,000 based on how this transaction had to have occurred on the beach and not a credit card transaction. And I doubt anyone's going to bring much money with them to the beach. Or here's one, who the heck is the mysterious tourist who purchased the head and has decided not to get famous by releasing it to the public or at least telling somebody about it and has decided to keep everything a secret? Was it frickin' E.L. Wallace again after he decided to move to Gambia? I personally really hope he's a reoccurring character in this saga. I want him to be like the G-Man of Globsters. I digress. Regardless, you know, some real names or really any physical evidence would be appreciated to validate the event beyond just take my word for it. Or what about all the locals suddenly, for really no reason at all, deciding to bury all the evidence of a possible discovery that won't only change a lot of the scientific community, but will make them famous? Also, how funny, nobody brought their cameras to the beach to photograph the carcass that day too. But they did remember to bring their machetes and shovels, clearly the more important things to bring to a day at the beach, or after hearing about an amazing discovery. There's a possibly new and amazing discovery that might make us all famous. What do? Kill it, bring machetes! In all seriousness, comedy aside, what I'm trying to say here is that the story doesn't make much sense, and when there's only the story to go off of, that's a bit of a problem. And that's not the only problem. The lack of evidence is startling. Again, no photographs of Gambo exist. I find this very suspicious and rather implausible. Owens forgetting his camera at home is understandable. But every single eyewitness that saw the carcass not taking at the very least one picture, really? Even in the late 1800s, when photography was a very difficult and expensive process, we have a vast array of photos of the St. Augustine monster. They might not be great detail, but at least something. This is the 1980s, when photography was easy and cheap. Even video at the time was widespread. Are we really led to believe everybody forgot their cameras at home that day and instead brought their machetes and shovels? If the supposed carcass existed, we are likely to assume to have gotten at least one photo of it, or at least one other sketch of it, not just Owen's account. I don't know, I find the whole thing rather suspicious. That the proposed best preserved lobster in recent history has no photos and has zero evidence to support that it even existed. And conveniently, it was quickly hidden and for some reason decapitated. Of course, before any real expert could examine it. Not to mention, Darren Nish points out, Owen's story is at times inconsistent. For example, he states that the sex organs or memory glands could not be observed due to them being too damaged to be recognized. Yet the carcass was laying on its belly, meaning that details such as this couldn't have been visible at all. Also, when considering Owen's story, it's important to remember that living plesiosaurs and pliosaurs were claimed to be alive in similar cryptid cases before and around the same time as the Gambo incident. The possible influence of such claims could have easily influenced hoaxing or misidentifications. Let's also not forget Owen's description of the creature doesn't completely fit the modern reconstruction of plesiosaurs. We now know even plesiosaurs had tail flukes, and not just like lizard tails. We know from several soft tissue impressions most, if not all, plesiosaurs, including pliosaurs, most likely possessed a vertical fin on their tails, something that wasn't widely known nor depicted in artistic representations of plesiosaurs in the 1980s, at the time of Gambo's sighting. And guess what? Gambo lacked this fin, sporting a lizard-like tail, just like most pop culture representations of pliosaurs at the time, and probably not how they actually really were. I'm not saying I don't trust Owens. Well, that's exactly what I'm saying. Many scientists have suggested that the carcass was nothing more than a mangled and badly decomposed shepherd's beaked whale, which had various traits either misinterpreted, exaggerated, or fabricated by Owen to make the carcass sound like an extinct marine reptile. The decomposed skulls of dolphins and whales, such as shepherd's beak whale, look surprisingly reptile and lizard-like to the untrained eye. Based on basically every other local identifying it as cetacean, as a dolphin, yeah, I think this explanation sounds right to me. But for matter of discussion, let's say Owen's description of Gambo was completely correct, and there really was a four-flippered, flukeless vertebrate carcass on the shore. Well, I can tell you that plesiosaurs and mosasaurs and all that junk aren't the most plausible conclusion, even if that's the case. It's worth mentioning mutant cetaceans possessing some traits common to that of Gambo have been observed. For example, in 2006, a dolphin with a fully formed pair of hind flippers was captured off the coast of Japan, and there are numerous cases of cetaceans, such as gray whales, that have completely lost their tail flukes, resulting in them possessing a tail that superficially resembles that of a marine reptile. All we need is for a mutant, deformed, four-limbed dolphin or a whale to lose its fluke and you got something that pretty much resembles Gambo. Something like a freak coincidence resulting in a cetacean with a flukeless tail and extra flippers can't be ruled out. Although unlikely, it's certainly more plausible than saying that it's an extinct reptile from a carcass we're not even sure actually existed. When considering Gambo, what sounds like the more likely conclusion? An over 66 million year extinct group suddenly appears out of nowhere and has basically zero evidence to confirm its existence besides a few eyewitness accounts, but no photographic evidence or samples? Or a known or even unknown species of dolphin or whale with several deformities known to appear in cetaceans to make it simply appear like a long extinct animal, such as an extra pair of flippers and a flukeless tail? Or how about this? It never even existed and is simply an elaborate hoax. Or it did exist but lacked many of the traits described by Owen and probably was a normal species of cetacean that was mutilated and hard to identify. This is a similar case to Trunco in the sense, although we can't reach a solid conclusion, that doesn't necessarily mean the most plausible explanation is that Gambo is a long-extinct plesiosaur or something unknown to science. There are numerous other explanations that are way more plausible and should be valued above this rather fantastical explanation until sufficient evidence says otherwise. Gambo was most likely some sort of mix between an actual carcass of a species of cetacean, likely a shepherd's beaked whale, that had a whole bunch of misidentifications and fabrications centered around it, blurring the truth. And to finish off this episode, let's examine probably the most famous globster of them all, the Zuayo Maru carcass, regarded by many to be the best evidence of post-KPG plesiosaurs. On April 25, 1977, the Japanese fishing trawler, the Zuayo Maru, was sailing off the coast of New Zealand, when suddenly, from a depth of almost 1,000 feet, something big was being hauled up from the sea. Entangled in their nets was a massive carcass possessing an appearance that would baffle both the crew and the public. The carcass was roughly 33 feet in length and was said to have weighed about 4,000 pounds. It was covered in, once again, fur-like filaments. See a common theme here. It lacked a dorsal fin and was said to have possessed four paddle-like flippers, although from the pictures I can only make out two, and a long neck, having been said to be measured between 5 feet to 6.5 feet. The specimen was in very, very advanced stages of decomposition. Theories amongst the crew ranged from rotting whale carcasses to a giant sea turtle whose shell had rotten off. One thing was clear, though. They could not solidly identify it. Unfortunately, the carcass was discarded and thrown overboard by the captain, Akitara Tanaka, who feared that the corpse would contaminate the rest of their catch. Fair enough. Several attempts were made to locate the carcass afterward, but all yielded nothing. Fortunately for us, the assistant production manager, Michiko Yano, took several photos of the carcass and even collected 42 samples for future identification, such as horny fibers from the fins. Smart man. He also made a sketch that isn't very helpful due to it contradicting several of his other measurements of the carcass as well as his photos. Upon returning to civilization, the carcass gained much attention. It was even taken so seriously that the Tokyo University of Fisheries held a special conference to discuss the discovery. The carcass was regarded by many to be a late surviving plesiosaur, an irrefutable proof that once thought to be extinct marine reptiles still roam our oceans. And, just like the Santa Cruz monster, creationists really, really like this guy for some reason. And, just like with the Santa Cruz monster, all these people got it completely wrong. The identity of the carcass is quite clear, and has been known for quite a while now, like a few decades. So what the heck was it then? It was, without a doubt, an owl. No, it was a basking shark. Several features of the carcass clearly display traits unique to basking sharks. As said before, the decomposition process in Zuayo was very, very advanced, meaning regardless of its identity, the living appearance of the creature would have been very, very different. And, as we have gone over before, the decomposition process of basking sharks leaves a carcass with a body superficially resembling that of a plesiosaur, with the gills and lower jaw rotting away very quickly, leaving what looks like a long neck with a small head. You can even see what is probably the lower jaw of the basking shark right here, as this V-like organ in the center of the carcass's chest. The picture also perfectly displays myokamata, connective tissue common in sharks and fish that connects the muscles and skin to the skeleton, on the backside of the carcass. Other traits examined in the carcass also betray this sharky identity. The anterior fin is said to be articulated at a right angle to the shoulder as it is in sharks. In one of the photographs, a dorsal fin is said to be visible. The fins were also claimed to have rays, a trait common with that of a shark or fish, and definitely not a plesiosaur, which possessed bony fingers. And last but not least, the horny fibers collected from the fins were found to be almost identical in chemical composition to that of a basking shark. Not to mention, sketches clearly state that the carcass possessed 6 to 7 vertebrae in the neck, with each vertebra having a diameter of 20 centimeters, which are also consistent with that of a shark. A simple overlay of the outline of a basking shark rather clearly illustrates the identity of the carcass. Almost all contributors to the Tokyo University Fisheries meeting concluded that the carcass was indeed a species of large shark, almost certainly that of a basking shark. It clearly wasn't a plesiosaur, that's for sure, for a bunch of reasons. For example, the neck vertebra count of even the shortest neck plesiosaurs, pliosaurs, was at the very least 13 vertebra, while in Zuayo it possessed 6 to 7 vertebra in its neck. If we are really led to believe this is a long-necked plesiosaur like a Elasmosaurus, as some proponents propose, which had at the very least 72 different vertebrae in its neck, then we are really severely lacking on vertebra count. So, case closed, the Zuayo Maru carcass was a shark, almost irrefutably a basking shark. The plesiosaur claim is just flat out incorrect. This has been known since the very first conference in 1977, yet some people still claim the incorrect plesiosaur explanation, like, once again, lost tapes. Alrighty, then that concludes this episode, and I hope you enjoyed it. Sorry for the prolonged wait on this video. I've been very, very busy lately, and hopefully these long intermissions between videos won't happen as often. I'll try to upload shorter videos to try to close the gap, too. Thank you so much for watching, and next week I'll be taking a break from cryptids and returning to Paleo Profile with a new video on the long-necked weirdo Tanistropheus. Stay tuned for one or two final globster videos where I'll just do a quick run-by on a few notorious internet and old globsters. Also, I think Uncivilized Elk found the real identity of the Flatwoods Monster.
No, you're confused.
Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.